Firing Line with William F. Buckley, Jr.
Professor Milton Friedman is considered by some people the leading economist in the entire world. That in itself is eye-catching, though, come to think of it, somebody has to be the leading economist in the entire world. The marvel is that Mr. Friedman is a conservative, or, to use the correct term, a classical liberal. Indeed, his sympathies can be inferred from his association with Senator Goldwater during 1964, whom he occasionally advised in economic matters. Mr. Friedman is the author of great and weighty works. His initial publication was fetchingly entitled Pigou's Standard for Determining Inelasticities. His latest and greatest work, in collaboration with Anna Schwartz, is A Monetary History of the United States, a work of seminal influence, which is causing as much stir in the world of Keynesian economics as The Origin of Species caused in fundamentalist Christian circles. Mr. Friedman is well known in the political community on account of several arresting contentions. One of them is that poor people tend to be hurt by existing welfare programs. Another is that we should altogether abandon such reliance as we now have on gold. A third is that we should institute a negative income tax, and still again, for that we should abandon the progressive feature of the existing income tax. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Friedman whether, in his view, the technical competence of Keynesian economists is now being challenged by his researchers.
I'm not sure how to answer that question. The problem is that the distinction needs to be drawn between the competence of the economists and the correctness of their analysis. I would not want to say for a moment that those economists who regard themselves as Keynesians are in any technical sense less competent than those who regard themselves otherwise. On the other hand, there's no doubt whatsoever that what now would be held and believed by people who call themselves Keynesian economists is very different from what these same people would have believed 10 or 15 years ago. The label may stay the same, but the contents designated by that label have gradually been changing.
Well, would you go so far as to say that your researchers and the researchers of other economists are such as to have rendered indefensible certain of the conclusions which were embraced almost dogmatically, say, 15 years ago?
Well, there's no doubt about that whatsoever. I don't want to take the credit for my researches, but there's no doubt about the fact that there is no economist today, or hardly an economist today, who would hold the same views that a large fraction of the economic fraternity held in 1945, 1948. For example, to take a particular case where the revolution has been most extreme, as of 1945, just after World War II, the great bulk of economists would have argued that money did not matter in any important sense. And by money here, I mean the quantity of money, not income, but the quantity of money. There's hardly an economist today who would argue that way. If you want to see how radical the change has been, you can do so most easily by comparing principles textbooks that were issued just after World War II and those that are coming out now, even, I may say, when they are different editions of
a
work.
Samuelson, for
yes.
instance. Yeah.
You compare the first edition of Paul Samuelson's Principles with the seventh, which is just out. You will find that in the first edition, there's a very small section on money, and he has nothing but negative comments to make about the quantity theory of money, about monetary control. He says it's of no importance. You look at his seventh edition, there's a very large and extensive section on the role of money. You will find that he talks about the quantity theory of money and the importance of monetary policy in a wholly different way, a much more favorable way than he did 15, 20 years ago.
Well, do you think that he and others have found this experience intellectually chastening? That is to say, have they proceeded to alter their approach to economics in a direction rather more scientific than theological, which it had become towards the end of Keynes' period?
Well, Keynes himself, I'm not sure I would agree with the implicit judgment about Keynes. Keynes himself was very much of a scientist. I think he was wrong on various things, but he certainly had a scientific approach. And indeed, I've always regarded it as a great tragedy that Keynes died when he did, because one of his great capacities was flexibility.
Yes.
He could shift as times changed. Had Keynes been alive, what is called Keynesian economics would never have been carried to the extremes. That is, had he lived beyond 1946, Keynesian economics would never have been carried to the extremes that it was carried. In his, the last article of his he ever wrote, which was published posthumously, he warned the economics profession at large that there was much virtue in old truths and that they should not be carried away by the new things. And there's no doubt that he wasn't at that point a Keynesian in the sense in which it was then interpreted.
Yeah, in fact, he went so far as to make complimentary observations about Mr. Hayek's book, didn't he?
Oh, yes, indeed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, Keynes was a great economist. We mustn't, it seems to me, you must avoid denigrating the man, because some of his disciples carried some of his arguments much too far. He was a great economist. He wrote very important works before his general theory, which is the work that got him his notoriety. And I think that had he lived longer, he would have led a retreat from the extreme position he took there.
So the generation of people who have who studied economics between, let's say, 1940 and 1952, 3, 4, 5, were more or less took it as received doctrine that the way to prevent excesses in economic cycles was through the manipulation of fiscal policy.
Yes.
And you say that increasingly they have now been become convinced that it is not fiscal but monetary policy that is crucial. Would you just define very briefly the difference between the two?
Yes. Fiscal policy has to do with the relationship between government spending on the one hand and government tax receipts on the other. The idea behind fiscal policy is that if the economy is depressed, the way to stimulate it is by increasing government spending relative to government tax receipts, either raising spending or reducing taxes. Monetary policy has to do with what happens to the quantity of money. And by the quantity of money, I mean the number of dollars you and I carry in our pockets, or the number of dollars there is to the credit of people at banks. Currency and deposits is what people ordinarily refer to by the quantity of money.
And you're in favor of increasing the amount of money generally available by a fixed rate.
Yes, well, that's true. That's right. Now, I think that there is a problem of fiscal versus monetary policy, but I think there is another issue which is just as important, which is, with respect either to fiscal or monetary policy, do you try to follow a steady course, or do you try, in the phrase which is certainly appropriate for this performance, do you try to engage in fine-tuning?
Yeah, yeah.
The idea of the new economics, so-called, it's really an old idea. It really was believed in the 20s, but it's been renewed, is that whether you use fiscal or monetary policy, you should try to use it in a very delicate and sensitive way, now expanding, now contracting, in order to offset other forces that are disturbing the economy. Here, I believe, there are two different points.
We'll continue our discussion on Firing Line in just a moment.
About the possibility of doing this through fiscal policy for both political and economic reasons, on the one hand. But, and therefore, they have turned increasingly to monetary policy. But then there is a further issue. I personally believe that we do not know enough to fine-tune with either fiscal or monetary policy, and that the best thing we can do is to try to keep either fiscal policy or monetary policy from disturbing the economy. You know, this is a funny thing. It's much broader in scope, Bill. The natural tendency for people, if anything is wrong, is to say, let's pass a law and have the government do it, without asking themselves whether the thing that is wrong may not have been produced by the government. Mm-hmm. We've observed this in various areas. A great problem of the nation today is the urban problem. But many of the things that are wrong in the urban area were produced by government. And what you need is not for government to step in and cure somebody else's misdeeds, but for government to stop making matters worse. And I think the same thing is true in the area of monetary and fiscal policy, that although the purpose of the government has been to offset other forces, the government itself has been the main major source of instability.
Well, would you carry that so far as to say that the welfare programs of the government have in fact militated against the diminution of poverty?
Oh, there's no question about that. The major source of poverty have been the welfare programs of the government.
How do you explain that? It sounds rather paradoxical, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. But, you know, there's a general economic principle that if there's a demand for something, a supply will grow up to meet the demand. And if you provide subsidies for people to be poor, there will be more people who will be relatively poor. But let's get down to specific details. Why is it that there are 25% of Negro teenage boys, male teenagers, young men between the ages of 16 and 19, are unemployed and walking the streets because of a government program supposed to be for welfare purposes, namely minimum wage rates? The government has legislated that it is far better for a Negro boy of 18 years old to be unemployed at $1.50 an hour than to be employed at $1 an hour. That's the only reason why unemployment among Negro youngsters is 25% instead of 7 or 8%, which is what it was before the minimum wage was raised so high.
Yeah, but it's also true that back before there was a minimum wage, there were also people unemployed, isn't it?
Oh, yes, but there was no such concentration of unemployment among the young people, among the unskilled, among the Negroes.
Well, there was the minimum wage in 1931, 32, was it?
Oh, we must distinguish between two different things, broad, general, overall unemployment. And of course, there was no minimum wage in 31, 32. There was enormous general cyclical unemployment. So, but my point is a different one. Here we have a time when unemployment in general, on the average, is low. It's only 4%. But it's 25% among Negro teenage boys. It's very high among the unskilled in general, much higher than it is on the average. If you go to an earlier period, when unemployment in general was 4%, suppose you go to 1955, unemployment then was about 4%. But at that time, the unemployment rate among Negro boys, teenage boys, was 8%, not 25%. Now, I quite agree that when you had a situation with total unemployment of 15%, 20%, as you did in 1931, that was not the result of minimum wage laws. That was a result of bad monetary policy.
Well, if it's true that positive action by government is a mistake in as much as it tends to exacerbate situations that it set out to cure, wouldn't it follow that your proposal for a negative income tax might actually create a larger class of indolent and unemployed than existing programs, or certainly than ideal programs? But first of all, you'd better explain your negative income tax, because it's frequently misunderstood.
Yes, it certainly is. The proposal for a negative income tax is a proposal to help poor people by giving them money, which is what they need, rather than as now, by requiring them to come before a governmental official, detail all their assets and their liabilities, and be told that you may spend X dollars on rent, Y dollars on food, et cetera, and then be given a handout. The idea of the negative income tax is to treat people who are poor in the same way as we treat people who are rich. Both groups would have to file income tax returns, and both groups would be treated in parallel way. Under current law, if you or I file an income tax return, and we have, let's say, I were a family of four, head of a family of four, to take a simple case.
But in fact, you do.
Well, I am, but as it happens, my children are growing up and they're not very good as, no good to me anymore as income tax deductions. That's one of the troubles with you kids growing up. Your parents lose you as a deduction.
And you don't tithe their earnings?
No, I'm afraid I don't tithe their earnings, and I'm afraid in the modern day, the parents continue to contribute to the children instead of the other way around. But under... if I were still a head of a family of four, I would be entitled to an exemption of $3,000 without paying a tax. That is, if I had an income of $3,000, I would have an exemption of $3,000, I would pay no tax. If I had an income of $4,000, I would have a positive taxable income of $1,000,
I would be required to pay a tax on that $1,000. Suppose I have an income of $2,000. Then by the same arithmetic, I have a negative taxable income of $1,000. Minus $1,000 is my taxable income. The idea of the negative income tax is to apply a tax rate to that minus $1,000 and give a man a subsidy in proportion to it. For example, the highest rate, it seems to me, at all feasible to use would be 50%, and it makes it simple for arithmetic. Let's suppose a rate were 50%. Then if I had an income of $2,000 with a family of four, I would be entitled to receive half of that $1,000 back. That is, I would get back $500 and end up with an income of $2,500 available to me. If I had zero income, if I had no income at all, then I would have a negative taxable income of minus $3,000. I would be entitled to receive half of that, or $1,500. And in this way, this program would say nobody in the country, no family of four in the country, shall have a smaller amount than $1,500 available for it for its purposes of consumption. That would be the negative income tax. Now, the point that I think it's urgent to stress to avoid misunderstanding is that while there's a guaranteed income, a minimum guarantee of $1,500, that income is not equal to the break-even point, the point at which you pay no taxes of $3,000. This difference is essential because there are other proposals which have been made under the name of guaranteed income which would say, let's set a level like $3,000. Then if a family has less than that, we'll make up the difference. Now, the trouble with such gap-filling programs, with a program which says, if you have less than $3,000, we'll make up the difference, is that you destroy the incentive of people to earn anything. Why should anybody go to work and earn anything? Now, under a 50% rate, you also weaken their incentive. And if you were starting from scratch, you might be adding to the problem. But you're not starting from scratch. Our present welfare programs, our present direct relief, and aid to dependent children programs, in effect, have a 100% tax rate. Because if a family on relief, if, let's say, a woman, as currently is mostly the case under aid to dependent children, if a woman who is on relief takes a job and earns $100, and she's honest, she is required to have her relief payment reduced by $100. That's one of the ways in which we've been producing poor people.
Yes, but it would be easy enough to modify that system without invoking your revolutionary substitute.
Not at all. Impossible. How?
Well, you say because it's politically difficult.
No. Never mind the political difficulty. How would you modify it?
Well, presumably by permitting her to keep one half of that
$100. Yes, but then look at what happens. Yeah. Let's suppose you go that route. Now I have two people, both of whom are working at the same job, both of whom have the same wage. But one of them, before he had that job or she had that job, was on relief, and the other was not. The person on relief ends up with a higher income than the person who is not.
Under the existing system.
Under your plan.
Yeah.
No, under your plan. If you were, in fact,
I haven't advanced the plan yet. But go ahead.
Under the plan you mentioned.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Under a plan where you said, well, now four people on relief, if they get a job, we'll let them keep half their earnings. Mm-hmm. The effect of that is to treat people who ought to be treated the same differently. It's thoroughly inequitable, and I think nobody would stand for it very long, because the man who says, now here I am, I got this
job. We'll return to Firing Line and William F. Buckley and his guest after this brief interruption.
Same pay, but came off of relief. The virtue of an income tax arrangement is precisely that it treats everybody the same way. Anybody whose income is $2,000 with a family of four gets treated exactly the same way, and there's none of this unfortunate discrimination among people.
Well, I see that point, and it certainly is a logical extension of the whole idea of rule by law. But in fact, don't we know from the evidence of our senses that the poor really are divided into two categories? There are the poor who are victimized by circumstances. Let's say a Negro who leaves the South, arrives in New York, and finds that he is not in command of any negotiable skill, though he is anxious to work. That's one category. But the other category, and it is generally estimated that this would make up for about 50%, or the so-called disorganized poor, the people who are poor because they are completely unmotivated And because there is some sort of a neurotic block that keeps them from acting in the way that if you deal with universals, you would expect them to act. Now, you say, or do you say, that they should be treated alike. What are you going to do with a poor person who, having consumed his $3,000 or whatever it comes it comes up to under the negative income tax, spends all of that on the races, and then turns to the community and says, this is the 2nd of January, and I have consumed my year's income. Now, meanwhile, I have 4 children.
Well, in the first place, the negative income tax wouldn't work along those lines.
You'd give them weekly payments.
I would treat the negative payments exactly the same way as you treat the positive income tax. What we do now is that a person who works files an exemption allowance and then gets his tax deducted at source from his wage. Mm-hmm. In the same way, for a person who works under a negative income tax, he would end up having his wages supplemented if he works, but his earnings are less than the exemption. He would end up getting his negative income tax
from
with
his
paycheck
yeah.
the same way, so he'd get it weekly. In the second place, those who do not work, if there are those who are not work,
that's the one I'm talking about,
are in the same position as those who do not work but have a positive income. They are required to file, you and I are required to file, an advance estimate of income and to pay our taxes quarterly. Similarly, on the negative side, if you had people with low incomes, they would file an advance estimate of their annual...
Such as zero.
Zero.
Say, yeah.
In which case, it would be calculated out that they were entitled to receive so many dollars a week or a month, and they would get it in weekly or monthly payments. Now, suppose you did all that. There undoubtedly would still be some people who would dissipate it on booze or on the races. There are now. Is there any doubt whatsoever that people on relief are able to find ways of getting around?
You may not be aware that I don't know how it works in Chicago, but for instance, in New York, there are direct payments by some of the welfare agencies to houses, landlords, that kind of business. And occasionally it goes so far at the discretion of the caseworker, direct payments to grocers, so that X amount of shredded wheat instead of X amount of pot is delivered.
I understand, but you and I understand the free market, and that shredded wheat, once delivered, doesn't have to stay in the home to which it's delivered. Let's not underestimate the ingenuity of the poor people in converting what they get from the relief worker to what they want.
That's true, but I think...
And that's just wasteful.
Yeah.
They would be far better off if we just gave them the money and let them spend it.
No, but it seems to me that some very intelligent critics of your proposal, who are as wedded as you to the same ideals of freedom and so on, do make the point that in a full employment society, when you have people who resist employment because they are undermotivated, precisely what they then need is to be treated not as members of an equal category, but as individuals with individual problems, and that precisely what therefore is needed is the administration of welfare.
Well, but let's take that argument. I think there's a great deal to the fact that many people do need this, but it's obvious that under present arrangements they don't get it. The welfare worker today is not really someone who is able. This is why welfare work is such an unattractive occupation, because a welfare worker is not in a position to help the relief recipient.
Well,
he is a policeman and a spy. He has to keep tabs on him to be sure he gets the money right.
Well, now, so is a school teacher. You can say that about a school teacher. But
yes,
you can also...
I would like to reduce the extent to which the school teachers are public servants and make them bring more competition into schools, too.
Yeah, but do you consider it a spy in that rather perfidious sense? If you actually look in to find out whether or not, let's say, the 4 babies have been fed in the last 36 hours, or whether they've been inoculated...
Yeah. That isn't what I was referring to.
Well, I would assume not. I would assume not. But therefore, the kind of spying that goes with caseworking is an act really of patronage, isn't it? That is to say,
no. The kind of
spying. It's in loco parentis.
No. The kind of spying I was thinking of was was standing outside a woman's apartment at 3 o'clock in the morning to make sure she is not entertaining a man who might be be charged with support for the children.
Yeah, these are abuses.
Or but making sure abuses. That the but they're mostly abuses. You have a system which stimulates abuse.
Aren't you evading the point?
Let me go back
that,
to your
abuse. Absent the abuses, you've still got a situation in which somebody has got to concern himself over the administration of the family by somebody who's a member of the disorganized poor. As I say, elementary things like have they had their vaccinations?
Let me take that. Let me go to that point. As I would say, first, at the present time, we're not doing it. In the second place, for a great large fraction of the people who are being helped, they have every incentive to do it themselves. If we give them the money, we will strengthen their responsibility. Third, under any system, you're going to have hardship cases. You're going to have the special problems. You're going to have the people you talk about. One of the great virtues of the negative income tax, in my opinion, is that by taking off the mass burden of income maintenance, it would make it possible for private charitable organizations to do a useful function of just the kind of thing you're talking about. I don't believe governmental civil servants can perform that function well.
Well,
I believe the great virtue of private charity has always been that it was able to be individualized,
sure,
and it was able to go to the particular person. The welfare, the governmental welfare programs have destroyed private charity.
Yes, but then of course the question arises as a political matter, just as, for instance, you have written that one of the weaknesses of Keynesian fiscal policy is political. You know,
yes,
it's hard to tax even in times of prosperity. But assuming that one were to launch the Friedman plan, isn't it likely in a democratic politics that you would end up increasing that lower level of guarantee to such a point as in effect to preempt the ad hoc supplements that would normally be given by your private and discriminating charities?
As you know, in politics, you can't win an election without a candidate. You can't beat a candidate without another candidate. And the situation now is the same. We're comparing alternatives.
Yeah.
The question is, of various alternatives, which is more subject to this danger? And it seems to me, experience suggests that our present welfare programs are clearly very much subject to this danger. Look at what's been happening. In a period of unprecedented prosperity and affluence, the number of people on the welfare rolls
has been
skyrocketing. Why? Because once they get on, we make it almost impossible for them to get off. In order for somebody who gets on to get off, he or she has to be able to have a really good job, because to earn a little bit, get off gradually, now doesn't pay.
Mm-hmm.
Under a negative income tax, you would have people give the poor people a possibility of getting off gradually. They can earn an extra $100 or an extra $200 and be better off.
Well, they would be earning...
We'll pursue these issues further in just a moment.
Of the a dollar and a quarter is too high. Let's shrink it down to 75 cents and ask whether or not people would be willing to wash dishes 8 hours a day for 32 and a half cents an hour, as opposed to simply doing away with that 32 and a half cents an hour.
Some
but,
of them...
But enjoying the usufructs of idleness.
Some of them might not. They do not now. Now you're asking them to do it for zero an hour. And at least at 32 and a half cents an hour, there would be a few who would, because they would see the opportunity of improving their condition by a small amount. I think, personally, I think that the great defect of our welfare programs and arrangements is that we have been too contemptuous of the poor. Our welfare, our people who have proposed these programs have treated the poor as if they were incompetent people who had to be managed by their betters. Now, I don't believe that's the case. I think most of the poor people are perfectly responsible, respectable people who, given half a chance, don't want to be on welfare any more than you or I want to be.
Well,
we've got to give them a chance to get off.
It's a matter of statistics, Ms. Friedman. I think that that's true about some of them.
Yes.
But I think it's also not true about others of them.
Of course.
The man whose judgment I respect most in New York City arrives at the generality that it's about half and half in New York City.
Well, wouldn't it be...
And under the circumstances, it seems to me improper to create an exquisitely rational program such as the one that you are suggesting, when, in fact, it's going to leave completely untouched and perhaps even worsened the 50% of the so-called disorganized
poor. Oh, I beg your pardon. It's not going to worsen them. It's going to give the opportunity a chance to work out. With respect to the other 50%...
It's obviously going to worsen them if, in fact, you make it possible for them to spend their income on matters that don't relate to health and shelter, whereas under the existing situation, you at least oversee that health and shelter are administered.
You're willing to take the word for the deed. You're willing to take the fact that you oversee for the fact that you accomplish something.
Well,
What you do in most of these cases is to have people waste, in order to get around you now, as they undoubtedly get around you, they waste some of what you give them.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
I grant, but you see, my moral premise is one that I know you're very sympathetic with, namely, that, and this is a strange for such a precisionist as you, when you talk about people being entitled to something, it is impossible to say that anybody is entitled to a negative income tax without saying that other people have a corresponding duty to make that available to them out of their surplus.
If I said that people were entitled to a negative income tax, I'm sorry, I didn't intend to say that.
Oh, that was quote unquote. Well,
all I have said is that we, those of us who are paying taxes, mm-hmm. have decided that we want to pay some taxes in order to provide assistance to the disadvantaged.
Yeah.
Now, it's perfectly appropriate for us to make that decision, but having made that decision, I would like to see us do it in a way which helps them as much as possible. On the contrary, I agree that as a moral principle, those of us who pay to provide subsidies for others have every moral right to say what it shall be used for. Mm-hmm. If we want to say we will give you money only if you use it to buy toothpaste and not for anything else, mm-hmm. that's our right. But I think we are very unwise to exercise it. I think we would be wiser and more truly charitable and do both them and ourselves more good.
Tell them to use it to buy a National Review.
Tell them to use it to buy to tell them to use it to buy what they will.
Yeah.
Beer, pushpin, whatever. Because in doing so, we not only give them more help immediately, but we give them an opportunity to develop their own sense of responsibility. You know, I'm sure we all do when we try to raise our children. We often see our children do something that we think is wrong, but we feel they must make their own mistakes because that's the only way they're going to learn to be responsible individuals.
Yes,
in the same way I feel
right.
this about...
Assuming you can program a normal evolution, but I think that one of the crises of the urban situation is that we are face to face with a sociological datum that we haven't coped with through traditional experience.
That's true. The question is, how do we reverse the process?
Yeah, exactly.
How do we get away from where we are now?
Yeah.
And nobody that I know of has proposed any alternative to the negative income tax as a way in which you can get out of your present mess in a gradual way without greatly hurting the people you're trying to help.
There's a question.
I was wondering if the negative income tax and the Council for a Volunteer Military and other right-wing libertarian proposals, if these wouldn't have a useful Trojan horse effect insofar as they're attractive to liberals and other leftists who unwittingly, therefore, would be supporting programs that lay the basis for further economic liberty.
Well, that's a complicated and difficult question. I think that one of the encouraging things is that so many of the people who have been in favor of welfare state activities and of increasing governmental intervention have been becoming disillusioned with it. And I do think it is desirable for those of us who share their ultimate objectives but who believe that they are following the wrong means. I think it's desirable for us to go along and try to develop programs which they can support. Now, this is, in a sense, a Trojan horse approach, and I have no objection to its being a Trojan horse approach. See, the thing that fascinates me is that as I talk with the people who regard themselves as welfare staters or liberals, I don't find the difference between them and myself to be very much in our objectives. We both want to achieve the same ends. The difference is in what means we think are appropriate to those objectives. Both they and I want to help the people who are relatively poor. Insofar as we can. We would like to have a world in which everybody has an opportunity to develop his own capacities. They think that enacting a minimum wage will help people. I think that enacting a minimum wage will hurt people. But in this respect, I quite agree that as they're becoming disillusioned with our present welfare arrangement, and if we can get them to support a negative income tax, maybe as they see how well a much freer and more libertarian approach works, maybe they will be induced to apply the same reasoning to the next problem.
Would you insist that you would not endorse the negative income tax unless it were agreed that a whole lot of other existing programs be repealed as part of the same reform?
Well, the problem is a whole lot. I think at the moment that, I would be definitely opposed to a negative income tax which was simply piled on top of our present welfare program. Mm-hmm. But I think...
Would you consider farm subsidies part of that welfare program?
No, this is what I was saying. That is, I think that the thing where you have the greatest hope and need for a substitution is that the negative income tax could replace direct relief and aid to dependent children.
Mm-hmm.
Those two programs are
money
intimately
consumer,
right.
Yeah.
And moreover, you see, the point is this. If you just added it on, but kept all of it.
We'll be back in a moment with more discussion by Mr. Buckley and his guest, Milton Friedman.
I agree. I think I would be opposed to it except as a substitute for welfare and direct relief programs. Now, as a long-run matter, I would hope that as we saw that this solved that problem, we could eliminate a lot of the other bad programs that we have, such as minimum wages, such as agricultural subsidies, such as urban renewal, such as public housing, and so on, all of which are programs intended to help the poor, but which hurt the poor. And I think that if we could really handle the problem of poverty by this one general measure, maybe we could get rid of some of these others.
Would you be in favor of eliminating the franchise, the vote, for people who are beneficiaries who fall in the negative level?
No, not at all. There was a day when that might have been possible. But you know, as I once said when I was asked this question, in the modern day and age, it isn't only the poor who feed at the public trough. And if you're going to eliminate the franchise for the poor who are helped by the negative income tax, then you must eliminate the franchise for the people in the oil industry who are helped by percentage depletion, for the people in the steel industry who are helped by tariffs, for the people in the radio industry who are helped by exclusive franchises for stations, and so on down the list. And therefore, I think there is no case in the modern day for making this particular invidious distinction.
Well, isn't, in the first place, that's not necessarily a bad idea, but in the second...
in the modern day and age, who would vote?
Yeah.
Here, neither you nor I. I could not vote because I am employed at a university which receives a large part of its funds from the federal government. For all I know, some of my salary comes from that way. You could not, surely you clearly could not vote because the National Review benefits from the postal subsidy. You're mailing...
No, we
under
don't,
present law,
we don't go out by first-class mail.
No, but that's all the worse. Under yeah, first-class right. mail, first-class mail more than pays its way. It's first-class mail that's paying your subsidy. Yeah. The subsidy is for third and fourth-class mail, which is being distributed at a cost considerable, at a price considerably below its cost.
Yeah, well, I think this is a reductio ad absurdum, actually, isn't it? Because, for instance, when John Stuart Mill recommended removing the franchise for people who, as he put it, were beneficiaries of the parish, he was living in an age where such observations as you just finished making also obtained, the tariffs and so on and so forth.
Very little. No, not at all. In John Stuart Mill's day, Britain had gone to complete free trade. There were no tariffs. In John Stuart Mill's day, I would have been in favor. I might well. I don't know whether I would have been. Mm-hmm. I can conceive of my having been in favor of the proposal. Because in John Stuart Mill's day, it's hard to see who was benefiting at the public trough except for people on the parish. There were no tariffs. There were no prohibitions on establishing newspapers or businesses or TV stations or other things through governmental control. Now, there was a postal subsidy.
Yeah.
Incidentally, I wonder, Bill, are you, as I am, in favor of eliminating the present provision that prevents anybody from carrying mail for profit?
Oh, certainly. Yeah.
Well, now, if we eliminated the post office, then maybe you could be entitled to vote. Yeah.
And it may be that the Democratic administration will do it for us. There's a question over here. Yeah.
Dr. Friedman, a few moments ago, you mentioned that you would substitute, you would use the negative income tax as a substitute for present welfare programs. Now, given that, it would seem that a family of four, which had which had no income at all for a given year, would receive $1,500 under your program. Now, they would actually be receiving less under your program than they would under the present system.
Not at all. You are making the usual mistake that people who live in New York tend to make of judging the rest of the country by this little parochial area here. If you look over the U.S. as a whole, you will find that $1,500 exceeds the welfare payments now being received by the great majority of states in the United States. Now, I want to emphasize that we have a federal system, that the circumstances differ in different states. Just as New York City now pays supplementary welfare benefits over and above the amounts that are paid in other states, so if you had a national negative income tax on the federal level, which would establish a minimum standard countrywide, there is no reason at all why any state which felt moved to do so, such as New York State, if it's particularly affluent and it wishes to maintain a higher standard of welfare payments, there is no reason why New York State could not have a supplementary negative income tax, just as it now has a supplementary positive income tax. And it would be perfectly easy to work the techniques to tie them together just as they are now tied together. What we're talking about, what I've been talking about, is a federal minimum standard. And if you look at the facts, you will find that the great bulk of the poor all over the country would be better off under the negative income tax arrangement than they are now.
Yes. Dr. Friedman, you suggested that your program would have its greatest effect if the bureaucracy of the present welfare system could be, in a way, done away with. And in view of the fact that the present welfare system is, by and large, operated on a state or local level, and your program is federal, I was wondering, how would this be accomplished?
Because while it's operated on a state or local level, a large fraction of the funds come from the federal government. And what I would hope would be that if the federal government moved to a negative income tax scheme for assisting the poor, the local and states would also move to such a scheme insofar as they supplemented the federal. You know, this is an interesting question you're raising. Most of the time, it's almost impossible to get rid of an entrenched government program because the bureaucracy has a vested interest and will fight it tooth and nail. The situation is a little bit different in this area. The reason is that being a welfare worker or a social worker under our present programs is such an unattractive job that there's an enormous turnover. And as a result...
Mr. Buckley and his guest, Milton Friedman, will have further comment in a moment.
There's an enormous... It's very hard to staff these programs because they're such unattractive jobs. The welfare workers object to them, and I don't blame them. They are right. They say, instead of our being able to help these people, we become their enemies. And we spend so much of our time in paperwork and in filling out the forms that we don't have time to do what we really would like to be doing.
Well, while we are reforming the sumptuary laws of the country, what about your proposal to eliminate the progressive feature of the income tax? Am I correct that you calculated a few years ago that if you eliminated all deductions, you could have a top rate of 23%, but also a minimum rate of 23% and raise the same amount of money?
Well, the situation now is even more striking, Bill, and it's this. You see, you don't really have a progressive income tax. If by progressive you mean higher rates on people of higher incomes, this is a semantic business, and I don't like to refer to the income tax as progressive, because that begs the question. It's graduated, not progressive. In fact, it's a retrogressive measure in terms of its effect on society and on the freedoms of our citizens. But if you look at the situation now, the graduated rates are a fake. The rates go from 14% to 70% at the top, but very few people pay the higher rates because the income tax law is so full of loopholes I mentioned some of them before in percentage depletion, but capital gains provisions, interest on state and local bonds, et cetera. There are so many loopholes that very few people pay it.
The effective rate being what, 45 or something like that?
No. Suppose you take the present law, Bill, and you take rates 14 to 70, and you do a bit of arithmetic. At those rates, people have reported on their income tax return a certain total amount of income. Mm-hmm. And you can ask yourself the question, what flat rate would give you the same amount of revenue? That's only arithmetic. And you were talking about 23%, you said 45%. We might get maybe we could get some of these students here to guess at what that number would turn out to be. If the range is 14 to 70, what do you suppose is the average single rate which levied on the amount of income now reported would give you the same revenue?
Do you happen to know the answer?
Yes, of course. You don't suppose. I thought you were aware of the professorial ethics. No professor asks the question.
I know the Socratic manner is not a game at which two people can play.
No.
What is the answer?
The answer is 19%.
19.
Now, in fact, if you substituted 19% for the present 14 to 70% rate, let's suppose you made no change in the law, except you put a flat 19% rate in
all income,
instead of 14 to 70, but let all the definitions. In fact, you would raise a good deal more money than you do now. The reason for that is it wouldn't pay people to get around the tax so much. Here's a man who hires an expensive accountant,
and
sets up a trust, makes gifts in order to get out of a 50 or 60 or 70% rate. For 19%, it wouldn't be worth his while. And thus, in point of fact, it's probably true that something like a 16%, 15, 16% flat rate on currently reported income, even without eliminating any of the loopholes,
would yield the same revenue.
Yeah. Now, in fact, if you eliminated the loopholes, what you ought to do, let me go back. Our present income tax is a mess. Partly, exemptions are lower now than they have ever been in our history in real terms. In dollars, they're the same as they were during World War II, $600 plus an allowance per individual for standard deductions. But in real terms, they're much lower because prices have doubled since then. And what we really ought to do to reform the income tax, and this would improve the negative income tax too, is to double exemptions, double present exemptions, eliminate all special deductions, substitute a flat rate for our present graduated rate. And if we do that, I have made a rough guess that if you doubled present exemptions, had a negative income tax below those higher exemptions and a positive income tax, and had a single rate of 25% up and down the scale, you'd raise as much revenue as you do now, after taking into account the negative income tax payments.
In other words, the exemptions plus the increased exemptions plus the negative income tax would make the difference between 19 and 25.
Oh, yeah. Well, you see, you'd be paying the 25 on a smaller amount of income because you'd have double exemptions.
Correct.
And maybe 25% is an overestimate. I just tried to get the largest number that would be necessary under those circumstances. But the main point I want to emphasize is that the people who say we are in favor of graduated taxation have to go to the next step and ask, say, do we now have it? And they must say to themselves, if they look at the facts, no. What we now have is a snare and a delusion. On paper, we have highly graduated rates. In fact, we don't. In fact, if you look at the average rate paid by people in different income classes, that rate is higher in the middle income classes than it is in the very highest income classes.
Because of financial mobility?
No, because the middle income classes tend to be have a much larger fraction of their income from wages, and it's harder to avoid taxes on wages. The higher income groups tend to have a larger fraction of their income from property, and therefore they can use capital gains, they can use state and local securities, etc.
I'm sorry, gentlemen, we appear to have run out of time. Our thanks to William F. Buckley, Jr. and his guest, Milton Friedman, and our audience, representatives of Fordham University.